Right. Well, hello everyone. Thank you for coming. I slightly modified the title of the presentation. I hope you don't mind. You'll see why in a minute. So today I want to talk to you about predators. Everyone loves predators. They are fascinating, they are cool, they are scary, and they also have many important functions in their ecosystems. And I want to focus on marine temperate ecosystems today. So one of the things that predators do in these ecosystems is they eat other things, specifically they eat lots of herbivores, and by doing so, they help the algae grow into these majestic forests, such as the ones we have in this picture. So for example, in Alaska, we have the sea otters eat the sea urchins that eat the kelp, and by doing so, they indirectly benefit. By doing so, they indirectly benefit the kelp. And instead, where sea otters were overfished, sea urchin populations exploded, and they consume all the kelp. So in the end, in the places where we had sea otters, the ecosystem looked like this. We had a productive, biodiverse ecosystem dominated by kelp, whereas in the places where sea otters were overfished, we had this poor ecosystem dominated by just a few species. So enough about Alaska. Let's get a little bit closer to home. Well, to my home anyway. And jumped into the Mediterranean Sea. This is how a healthy Mediterranean ecosystem looks like. We also have nice algal forests. They are not as tall as the kelp forests, but you know, they serve a similar purpose. They also are very productive. They also support lots of biodiversity. And this is how most of the Mediterranean used to look like many years ago. This is a photo from the early days of Jacques Cousteau in the 1940s. And we can see that these algal forests are still there. We have also lots of fish. However, this is how most of the Mediterranean looks like today. The algal forests are gone. We only have this desert of bare rock just covered with urchins. So what has gone wrong? If we have a look at the food web, we see that in fact it's not that different from the one in Alaska. We have this sea urchin that eats all the algae, and this sea urchin is eaten by mainly by this fish, Diplodocus argus, but also by some invertebrate predators such as sea snails. So one might think that the problem is that these guys right here are not eating enough urchins. There is not enough predation because just as in Alaska, we have overfished the predators. Indeed, if we go and look at places where we have few predators because they are overfished, such as outside marine protected areas, which look like this, and we compare their predation impact with marine protected areas where we have lots of predators, we do indeed see that the predation impact is quite different. However, if we go back to the same sites on another season, these differences are not so clear. And indeed, if we survey a whole bunch of other sites, we see that predation is in fact very variable, especially. So even though it's important in determining the grazing impact, there are other factors that also affect it. So that got me thinking, so okay, what is it that predators do? They eat things and they also scare things. So I asked myself, is it possible for predators to influence or benefit the algal forest by just scaring the sea urchins, by modifying how they behave? And to answer this question, we performed a series of studies in the northwestern Mediterranean, where we basically looked at the urchin abundance and the urchin behavior in two sites. One site that has lots of predators because it's a marine protected area, the Medas Islands, and another set of sites that are not protected and they have few predators or no predators because they are overfished just as the rest of the Mediterranean. So to put it nicely, we're interested in knowing if predators limit the urchin abundance by eating them, by consuming them, the so-called consumptive eggs, but also if they modify how urchins behave. And specifically, we were interested in knowing the grazing activity and the habitat use. So as it turns out, predators do a really good job in limiting urchin densities. The urchin densities inside the marine protected area where there are lots of predators were far lower than the non-protected sites. And so we can safely say that by keeping low numbers of herbivores, predators benefit the algal communities. However, the non-consumptive effects were also very significant. So this is, urchins will typically shelter inside crevices such as this one in the rock, And when they come out to feed, in the long term, they create this, their grazing activity creates this area of bare rock, which we call a grazing halo. And this grazing halo is half the size inside the places where we have lots of predators. So urchins in these sites are scared and they barely come out of the crevices. So it's a way for predators to limit urchin grazing impact. So urchins are scared of fish, but urchins are also scared of their predators. In laboratory experiments, if we have some sea urchins feeding on algae and we expose them to a chemical cue from one of their invertebrate predators, they also stop feeding and reduce their feeding rates. And interestingly, we see a very similar thing if instead of exposing them directly to a predator cue, we expose them to a cue from a crashed sea urchin simulating a predation event. So these results are telling us that urchins can sense their predators in two ways. One, directly, by sensing the chemical cues from their predators, but also indirectly by sensing the cues released from damaged sea urchins. Predators also play a very important role in determining the spatial distribution of sea urchins. So where there are fewer predators, we find higher numbers of sea urchins exposed, so like this, just feeding in the open, which is what this graph is telling us. However, interestingly, even in those sites, urchins still use crevices. They are still found inside refuges. And that's very interesting. And if we look at these results more closely by separating them by size classes, so here we have urchins 3 centimeters, 4 centimeters, 5 centimeters wide. Right here we have the frequency on which they occur. And in blue we have if they are sheltered inside the crevices, and in green we have if they are exposed outside the crevices. So interestingly, even large sea urchins, 4 or 5 centimeters wide, that according to the literature, they are apparently free from predation because they are too big to get crushed for predators, they are still using these crevices. The blue predominates. This is a very interesting result that needs further investigation. We have some hypotheses, but it needs further testing. So I like to think about Mediterranean or temperate marine ecosystems as they remind me as the garden I have back home. So yes, I'm not crazy. They are also green. They produce some tasty goods. They provide us with some benefits, such as recreation. So yeah, they are similar, very similar in many aspects. And just as in temperate ecosystems, sometimes in my garden I get these explosions of nasty herbivores that eat all my plants. And you know, now I know what to do. I just need to bring in some predators. They will do two things. One thing, they will eat some of the sea urchins, mainly the small ones, and benefit the plant, so I can get some of those tasty goods back. But also, they will function as a scarecrow, and they will scare away the rest of the sea urchins, just forcing them into hiding, and severely limiting the impact, so I can get my lovely vegetables back. So the good news is that by recognizing these two important functions of predators, we can identify these species for protection. So, and that's crucial if we want to get back this lovely algal forest from the past. It's not a big deal for fishermen, but because there are only few species that need to be protected. There are only several species that eat sea urchins. But it's a big deal for the system, because this way we can get this algal forest back. So yeah, thank you very much for listening.
Bravo! Bravo!